All right. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone from different time zones. Welcome for yet another program with Cyberoam Tech Talk on Thursdays. Today we're going to talk on two-factor authentication with Cyberoam, understand the challenges of two-factor authentication and the solution of two-factor authentication. So before we proceed, we will be conducting a short session of question and answers following the presentation and the walkthrough of the demonstration which we have lined up for you today. And you can have please note down all your queries and concerns, and I'll be happy to answer them at my best. Please check your audio settings accurately. It seems some of you are not connected to any of the audios. And I hope you're able to view the screen, and I am loud and clear. So one voice, am I audible clear enough? Okay, so let's begin. So the agenda for today's presentation is to understand passwords and the challenges, two-factor authentication in general, and what Cyberoam two-factor authentication offers us. I'll show you the configuration on the two-factor authentication. We're going to use the example of integrating Cyberoam with the RSA Radius server. I already have a lab setup configured in my premises, which where we have RSA configured and integrated with Cyberoam. I'll run you through the screens of configuration, and also I'll demonstrate onto the authentication process with the PIN and passcode with the RSA soft tokens, though I'll not be able to demonstrate on the hardware tokens. So what are passwords? This is a very typical and a very known answer to all of us, typical passwords which everybody uses in on the internet. So the remembering all different passwords from different sites which supports different kinds of alphanumeric and symbols and all different kinds of characters. So this becomes very difficult for one to remember all the like I have to remember my password for my bank account. If I have multiple bank accounts, I have to remember password for multiple bank accounts, as well as I have email account from my office, so I keep a track of my passwords from my office accounts, and XYZ, you go to Facebooks and all the different websites you access, you are a partner to some vendor, so there is a vendor management page where you have different accesses and passwords. So remembering a password is again a task to by itself. So as a general tendency, what you do is note down in a notepad or save it in an Excel file onto your computer system. Often shared with the trusted people like colleagues or your family members. My wife always does this with me. I mean, we share a common account for the bank account, but that's a very surprising thing that we have a common account, and I always have to pay up for that. However, on the darker side is that we share a common passcode for that particular account. So this is a very typical flaw which normally everybody falls into the trap of. Then update it periodically for added security. Now there are updations. Now from time to time, you have to keep changing the password. So again, you know, change the passwords for all those websites and accounts you have. And otherwise, there is one password for all. Now, just to eliminate all the above queries, you keep one password for your banking, for your email, for your social networking, for your FTP, VPN, ATM PIN as well. So this is quite a challenge in terms of identity theft. One password for all, one lost, everything is lost. Impersonation, user impersonation, easy to steal with keyloggers. Now, there are malwares which automatically gets installed onto your system. You don't even know those malwares. In turn, install a keylogger onto your system and they track of your passwords which you use in your day-to-day activities. Also, the challenge is to protect against password stealing malware, which I just mentioned a couple of seconds back. So these are the different challenges which one comes across in while maintaining the password on World Wide Web. You see on the screen we have a couple of advertisements, a couple of news flashing, like one of the news which is a California student's busted for high-tech grid-changing scam where keyloggers were installed onto the computers of teachers and they sold the test answers to the other students. So this is one of the activity which was carried out in terms of stealing of passwords and stealing the data. Beware of bank account and password stealing incident viruses. Like we are aware about phishing, where you have different kinds of emails claiming that they are from your banking, your bank account, your banks, and they ask that they're going for an upgrade onto the system, and they would request you to make changes onto your accounts, and you fall into the trap of this hoax email which is sent to your mailbox, and as an ignorant user, you log on and you type in your password, and those password is now with the hacker. So let us understand that what is two-factor authentication. Two-factor authentication adds an extra layer of security. It enforces the user to enter a verification code in addition to their username and password. It also protects against unauthorized access, identity theft, and online frauds by impersonation. So two-factor authentication has been brought into the picture where something you know, which is a PIN or password, and something you have, which is a token, a smart card, or a trusted device. So the combination of you know and you have makes it very difficult to guess the passwords or to lose the passwords onto the internet. While you have this combination, it makes it very secure for you to access the critical data which you're accessing over the World Wide Web. So what are the methods to implement two-factor authentication? There are two different methods which to implement the two-factor authentication, one of which is to use hardware tokens, USB flash drive tokens, smart cards. As you can see onto this slide, there are RSA security flash cards, smart cards, which has numbers which keeps on flashing after every second, after a few time period. And then in combination, we have software, mobile phones, and SMS tokens for web application access. So these are called on-demand secure tokens or also OTPs. Now, it's a very typical example of this two-factor authentication. If I have to give you, is like you would normally access your internet banking account from your location where the bank or where your the city you belongs to, and basically they track the IP addresses from where the bank website is being accessed from. The moment you change your location, once you move out from one place to another place, you know, the system identifies that the request is received from another location and might be a possibly identity theft. So there they prompt, they give you a prompt to go with the one-time automatic generated password or a PIN which is sent out to your registered email address or maybe perhaps your registered mobile phone. So once you have that unique combination of the PIN and the passcode, you are then further only able to access your internet banking account. So there are Keystone Dynamics, also voice print, biometrics, and virtual smart cards as well. So these are the different two-factor authentication methods which one can implement into their day-to-day activities. So what is the use of this two-factor authentication? It's not only just used with banking, but also social networks like Google, Facebook, and Twitter have included two-factor authentication. If you see under the screen on the Facebook where you are trying to locate, recently my job makes me travel to different places, and the last place from where I have accessed my Facebook account to socialize with my family, and then I moved to another place, it asked me to verify whether I am the actual person behind accessing the Facebook account. So basically, those are the two-factor authentication implementations whereby at times you have to also, they ask you to, you know, verify the pictures of your relatives or friends which are your connecting people into your account and where you have been tagged as one of the friend or the family member into the photographs. So there are different methods and different implementation of these two-factor authentications where, you know, not except for the banking concept. So how this two-factor authentication works? So two-factor authentication works on this simple equations. There is a passcode. There is a passcode. A user enters the passcode, and an authentication manager, that is your integrated solution, your perhaps if today for today's scenario, for today's presentation, we have RSA integrated with Cyberoam. So my authentication manager is my RSA server, Radius server. It calculates and sends a challenge response to the user or authentication request which is sent by the user. So passcode, what is a passcode? Passcode is a password which you give it to the user or user changes by itself, and a token code. Token code is something that you have physically with you, and it keeps on changing randomly and dynamically every periodically. And password is something you know. So in the combination of password and token code, the system authenticates you further. Okay. So understanding the challenge response here is a typical Radius client and server request and reject information, where you see initial request is sent from the Radius client. The client here in our example is going to be the Cyberoam. Cyberoam is Radius client, and the server, Radius server, is the RSA integrated solution. So the request as a user is received from Cyberoam as a request to the Radius server. Radius server will either send an accept message where the user is granted access or a reject, thereby if the user is failed to provide proof of identification or user account is disabled or inactive or any XYZ reasons. And if the user is accepted, then the challenge is sent with an additional information from the user such as PIN, token, or OTP. So Cyberoam's two-factor authentication. So Cyberoam supports the two-factor authentication for on the challenge and response based, as well as the solution is compatible with solutions such as RSA Security, Vasco, Aladdin, SMS passcodes, OpenOTP, etc. These are all tested solutions. There could be many more which Cyberoam are also integrated with because of its nature of open sources and all, and also supports OTP token. Now, where can you integrate your Cyberoam device? You can integrate Cyberoam device to provide two-factor authentication for a captive portal, for a web admin console, that is the GUI which you log on to access the Cyberoam configuration details, My Account, you can also use it for reports, and the most important which you can use it for is VPN. On VPN, you can use the two-factor authentication with SSL VPN portal, SSL VPN client, or OpenVPN SSL over iOS, that is the Apple operating system, and the Android operating system. Okay, so let us have a quick look onto the configuration of Cyberoam. I'll just walk you through the Cyberoam's configuration, and I'll also show you the RSA configuration, which is done, and how Cyberoam is integrated, and also demonstrate the two-factor authentication process. And so quickly, let me log on to a Cyberoam device. This is a Cyberoam device which is configured and integrated with RSA integrated solution. So I'll log on to Cyberoam device, go to Identity Authentication. I add the server as a Radius. And this is how my Radius server is configured. This is the IP of my Radius server, 10.20.21.23. It works on authentication port 1812. And the secret is, the shared secret is provided by the Radius server. So I will integrate Cyberoam with the Radius server test connection. There's a use test, 1234. So test connection is successful. So my integration of Cyberoam with Radius server is complete. Secondly, I have to choose the Radius server in my as an authentication server under firewall. This is very important. If you do not choose this, Cyberoam will never ever send the request to the Radius server. Similarly, if you want the Radius server to be authenticated for VPN connections, you have to select onto the VPN parameters as well. Okay, so once this is done, now you have to log on to your RSA security console. This is how it looks like. There is a user called Matthew, and I have, for the demonstration purpose, assign a software token to this user named Matthew. There is a file which is downloaded. There is a software which is downloaded onto my system, as you see over here. Okay. So this is a software token which is randomly generating the token code. So I import the serial, there is a certificate file which is imported onto this client, your token client, which you downloaded from the Radius server. So once this is integrated, this is my Radius client. My Radius client is, scroll down to CR. This is my Radius client. Radius client is my Cyberoam's IP address, which is sitting behind the Radius server. So what is the server? Server is my 10.20.21.253, which you can see what is it configured over here, 10.10.21.253. This is Meridius server. Okay? So now, my integration is done with RSA tokens. There is a software token which is loaded. I have uploaded as a user. I'm traveling after the office. I want to connect back to my office network using the SSL VPN. So I have been provided an SSL VPN URL to access my office resources by the IT team. So I log on, I connect to the internet, and access the SSL VPN portal. So this is where my name, I have to give my username and my password. My first time password would be the token code which I have. I copy the token code and paste it and give the login request. Now next prompt, this I get from the Radius server is enter a new PIN having from 4 to 8 alphanumeric characters. So I have to create a new PIN which will be used for my future logons. Confirm the PIN. Now here, I have been asked for the challenge. The PIN is accepted. Now wait for the token code to change, then enter the new passcode. So I have to wait for this token code which I used initially to change and then use this token code in combination with my PIN. Okay? So PIN plus token code is equal to my passcode over here. So this is the first time process which one will have to follow to generate the PIN. So let us wait once this PIN token code is changed. Okay, so now we have this new token code. I copy this token code, enter the PIN plus the token code and continue. So now I can access my SSL VPN portal. Okay? So it's just very simple. Now let us check the logs on Cyberoam device. I go to log on to the GUI, go to logs and reports, log viewer, authentication logs. Here, you see this is user Matthew received a challenge. This challenge is when I was prompted for the PIN. So successfully, I was able to log in with the combination of a PIN and the token code, and which is authenticating with the RSA tokens. So this is how you. This is also a short configuration in terms of integrating Cyberoam device with RSA secure token secure IDs. And similarly, you can, as explained in the previous slides, you can integrate many other solutions like Vasco, Aladdin, and different kinds of solutions with Cyberoam. So on the next logon request, now let me log out again. On the next logon request, I do not have to follow the procedure again. I just have to remember the PIN which was generated by me. So I will enter the PIN and the new token code as my passcode. And I'm logged into the SSL VPN portal. Okay. So that brings an end to our presentation for today on Cyberoam Tech Talk with two-factor authentication. I'll be most happy to answer your queries and concerns, if any. Yes, we have a very good question. How about Radius with TLS? Is it supported by Cyberoam? I'll have to check with this. I'm sure this is also supported, TLS with Radius. I'll have to get back to you onto this, Marek. Thank you. Guys, any more questions? Alan, any question for you? Yes, we have it in the roadmap. There's a question where whether we have we have this feature of integrating OTP server on Cyberoam. It is not there in this year's roadmap, but depending on your depending on the market feedback, we might bring in to the roadmap. Depends on what kind of requirements we have. As of now, it is not there in this year's roadmap. I hope I've been able to answer your question, Philip. Is it in the roadmap for 2014? 2014 roadmap? No, it is not there at present, but it seems that you are quite curious and eager to have it in the roadmap. Do drop us an email on having the requirement. We will have a look. We will consider a requirement after going on to the details and the requirements provided by you, and thereby we can bring it onto the roadmap. Thank you, Philip. Any more questions? Okay, it seems that we are running out of the questions, don't have any questions anymore. Thank you very much for your time today. Keep watching for the space, keep watching for the future webinars on www.cyberoam.com/webinars.html, and request you to register for the upcoming interesting topics as well. Thank you very much for spending the time with us. Thank you. Bye-bye, goodbye, have a nice day.